although we are miles apart.
If you ever need a helping hand, I'll be there on the double that's as fast as
I can.
And Tennille. That was a great clip. Wow.
I haven't seen that since we did it, which
was
back
grooves.
In 1980. Oh, there was some great stuff. That
was going on there.
Now, you guys have sold 23 million albums.
I guess.
That's news.
Whoa! We bought 10 million, didn't
we? Yeah, we did.
Oh, yeah. Now, you know, obviously, you know, you guys are successful now, but when was the first point in your career that you said, you know what, we're a phenomenon? When did it happen for you? Was there any kind of a nudge? Did something happen specifically?
Well, to me, the most exciting moment was when we were driving down the freeway in Los Angeles in the summer of 75. It wasn't even the summer. It was before that we started climbing up the charts.
Started breaking the spring, yeah.
Started breaking the spring. And we heard Love Will Keep Us Together on KHJ, which was the big, hot, top 40 station at
now
the time.
Talk show.
Now it's a talk show. But then if you were on KHJ, you had it made. And I was so excited. And I had to stop and pull into a gas station and just listen. And the other neat thing was when you're driving along and you pull up at a stoplight and you hear your song coming out of somebody else's car radio.
Yeah, I know how that,
that
is. Yeah.
Was, you know how that is, Dwayne.
Yeah.
That's when I knew that something had happened.
Wow.
That was great. It really
now,
was.
Now, did you guys do, when you got all this money and stuff, did you do anything extravagant? Or, you know, did you guys like taking baths and champagne, you know, partying it up, you know? What did you do?
I got some calls from my relatives.
Oh, that's the first thing that happened.
Yeah, yeah.
Relatives you don't even know about.
Yeah, you never heard before. Actually, we bought a house. We bought our first house.
Where?
In Pacific Palisades.
Just down from Reagan.
Uh-huh. And then when we moved up to Northern Nevada 14 years ago, we sold that house to Stephen Bochco. So the producer of Hill Street Blues and
all
that.
NYPD Blue.
Exactly.
So that means that he gave you some NYPD green.
He gave us a lot of NYPD green.
Because I know he didn't buy no shabby hut.
No, he didn't. He didn't.
All right. You guys, I mean, everyone thinks of you as like, you know, the mom and pop and, you know, like really respectful and classy. And,
right on.
But
I like that. I like classy.
You guys have been banned from radio before.
Oh, you know, this
I mean, I know you don't want me to bring it up. Henry Kissinger?
Oh, well, the thing that we were banned for, all of you are going to laugh because of what happens today in lyrics, but I wrote the second million seller we had is a song I wrote for Daryl. The first song I wrote for him called The Way I Want to Touch You. And they literally would not play it on a radio station in St. Louis. They said it was too risque. The Way I Want to Touch You, I mean, come on with what's happening today.
Well, Charo covered that song.
Charo did a nice version
and
of it.
And it was risque.
It was risque when
Charo did
it.
Charo did a nice version of it.
I never wanted
Charo.
I never wanted to touch.
She put a couple of X's on the end of that song.
Oh, she did.
Charo.
She jumped right in Daryl's lap and sang it right to him.
What?
Woo!
Did you get jealous?
Well, no.
Now, Muskrat Love.
Yeah, Muskrat
was
Love.
Was another one that has some explicit lyrics. Well,
now,
I hear.
Hey, I didn't write Muskrat Love. Willis Allen Ramsey wrote that. He's a guy that lives in Texas. And, you know, Daryl and I have never met Willis. I've talked to him on the phone once.
Well, he writes about animals, doesn't he, man?
No, he doesn't write about animals.
Me and my bear, yeah. Me and my moose. I mean, you just write about animals?
Well,
that?
No, he doesn't, but he writes kind of quirky, unusual tunes. He writes for Lyle Lovett today a lot. You know, Lyle Lovett's tunes are a little unusual.
Kooky. Yeah,
yeah, he's kooky. So, but we actually sang Muskrat Love, and this is the truth. We sang it at the White House. It's a long story, but we sang it in the East Room of the White House. We were invited by President and Mrs. Ford to perform there over the bicentennial celebration. And the East Room is a very small room, if you've ever seen it. It's very small.
Yeah, I go there all the time.
You go there all the time. And so in the front row, the Queen was there because it was the bicentennial and all that. So here's the front row, and I'm sitting playing a keyboard at that time. President Ford and Mrs. Ford, Queen Elizabeth, Prince Philip, she was asleep, but he was having a great time. And right in front of me, close enough to touch, Henry Kissinger.
He literally was like 4 feet.
Yeah, right here. So when I started singing this song and I watched on his face as he realized I was singing a song about two muskrats in love in the White House, the look on his face was amazing. But later on when Daryl made those little muskrat sounds like are on the record, Henry wanted to be anywhere but where he was.
What? Now, we have a clip of you singing Muskrat Love. Let's go to the song that made Henry Kissinger horny.
Any whirl, any twirl, any tangle, singing and jinging a jangle, float like the heavens above, looks like muskrat love.
Secret. The captain, don't get jealous, but I fell in love with Tony right there when I saw that on your show.
When you saw that was it, that did
man,
it?
Man, I was like, wow. You, Linda Carter, and Lindsay Wagner, the Bionic Woman, Wonder Woman, and you.
And me.
I was like, muskrat love.
You like tall women, don't you, Dwayne?
It was just so sweet. It was such a sweet song.
Oh, it was sweet. I'm glad you understand that because it did make Dave Barry's book of worst songs ever done.
Really?
Recently, yes. But Dave doesn't have a sense of humor.
And you know what? None of us know Dave.
We don't know Dave. I will never have him on this show.
No, he won't be here
never,
with me.
Never. Right.
But I do want to talk about marriage, man. I mean, you guys have been married for 23 years. Now, in L.A., to be married a year, you have to count it in dog years. So every year you're together in L.A., that's like 7 years. So you guys have been together like 161
exactly,
years.
Exactly, yeah, that's right.
You know, and I want to know your ancient secret. What's going
ancient
on?
Ancient secret? Well, you
wait,
really...
Wait, before you tell me what the secret is,
okay.
I want to bring my wife out here because...
Oh!
My beautiful wife, Tisha.
Tisha!
Cameron Martin. She's going to take some notes. Take notes, baby. All right, she's going to talk. Yeah.
One.
Okay. Number one.
One.
Two bathrooms.
We got that.
You gotta have that.
Toothpaste.
Two
close-up.
Everything.
You listen, she'll tell us.
All right. She's already way ahead of me.
I got the toothpaste.
Two of everything. When you go on the road, if you're on the road together, two rooms connecting. That way there's no question you've got your own space. Space is important.
Gotcha. In case you get into a little brawl, you go, you know, go to your room, I go to my room.
Just for any reason, just to be able to have some space. Mm-hmm. Just because you're married doesn't mean you have to be jammed up next to each other all the time, you know?
Yeah.
Isn't that right?
I'm going to take some notes here.
Speaking of jamming.
Yeah.
Let's talk about loving.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah. How long have you been married?
Oh, only a year.
We've
been dating 7 years. But.
Oh, well.
We've been dating 7 years. We've been married for 7 years.
Okay.
Dog years. 1 year.
1 year. Dog year. Okay, so now let me ask you this.
Yes.
Can you picture each other, the two of you, when you're very old, very old, you know, in your 80s, still enjoying each other, still laughing, still having fun together?
Yep.
Can you?
Yeah. I sure can.
Okay, then you're going to make it. You're going to make it. That's good.
I'm going to be in my little roller.
Your little walker.
And she, you know,
I got the pins on.
You know, you guys stay young forever. She's going to be dating like Jodeci or somebody, Boys and Men, some young group, the little group, the doo-wop, bop-wop, doo-wop guys. And I'm going to be old just.
No, if you keep the humor, I think the humor is real, real important.
Right.
And do you talk easily? To each other.
Yeah.
I mean,
yeah, we got that.
Nobody ever goes and closes the door and says, "Don't talk to me."
Nah, we got that book. Men are from Mars, women are from Venus. So we're doing all right.
Well, I've never read it, but I'm sure it works out
it's
just
great.
Perfectly.
Well, we're gonna go to a commercial right now, and we're gonna come back with more of Captain and Tennille.
All right.
All right. It is a pleasure to present to you guys one of my favorite groups, Captain and Tennille.
And we're gonna start with your favorite song, Dwayne.
Muskrat, muskrat, candlelight, doing the town, doing it right, and they.
Dancing in a tango, float like the heavens above. Looks like muskrat love. And here's one I wrote for Daryl. Do that to me one more time. Once it's never enough with a man like me. You too, Dwayne. Do that to me one more time. I can never get enough of a man like you. Kiss me like you just did. Oh, baby, do that to me once again. Sing it, Ruth. You now and I need you then, just stop.
I just want to say in closing, guys, that you can, Captain and Tennille, they're still touring. They're going to be in L.A. October 11th.
10th.
I'm thinking about my birthday, August 11th.
Oh, happy birthday.
October 10th at the House of Blues. You can catch him. Be there or be square.
Yeah.
We're going to take your marital advice.
I love it.
And if you don't mind, we'd love to hear something as we go out.
We do it right now. That it?
Shop around.
Uh-huh.